welcome to the NewsX Sunday Guardian Roundtable. Well, this week we're discussing something pretty interesting. We're discussing what has been India's most defining decade. Of course, we're taking 1947 as granted. But after that, has it been, say, the 50s when the foundations of a country were laid, we had the constitution? Or is it after that, the 70s, what I would call the Durga years, when we had the nuclear test, we had, of course, the Bangladesh war, the creation of Bangladesh? Or is it later, the 80s, where the foundations of digital India were laid, the 90s, or else now, where we see the rise of the Hindu right, the rise of the social media? So that is something we are going to be discussing on Roundtable today.
Now, you see, two things happened in the 90s. One was that 40 years of the Soviet model was junked. And the growth rate went from 3.5% per year for those 40 years. During the Narasimha Rao period, even touched 8%. So that was a great. Second is the Ram movement.
Oh, yes.
Which created first a two-party system and now perhaps once again a one-party system. But the fact that Congress need not rule, consciousness came only in the 90s. So I would consider the 90s.
If you were to ask me as I look back on these 70 years, I think the first decade after independence
50s.
Played an exceptionally crucial role in defining the evolution and future of India. We had one freedom, but it was in a formative stage. Many of the ideas were as yet fragile, looking for an institutional anchor. And at that time, the emphasis on a democratic India. And we saw how many nations initially began as democracies and became dictatorships.
Yeah.
The ability to steer India on its course to a democratic India, to a secular India, to an India which integrated itself thanks to the efforts of Sardar Patel, among others who played a leading role. That creation of India at that foundational stage and the set of ideas that still define the idea of India, for me, make that stage particularly important because the rest was built on that foundation.
The decade of the 90s and the present decade, I think both would really run very close. The decade of the 90s for very, very obvious reasons. One, we started on a very low. We had political crisis, we had financial crisis, the economy was in doldrums, the Cold War had ended, so your only international support was gone. So we started from that. Forcibly, whatever reasons, we broke into economic reforms. We understood that the old model was not working. And we end the decade with both the nuclear explosion at Pokhran, the real one. The 74 one, we hid it by calling it peaceful. We didn't have the courage to own it up. And the 1999 Kargil war, which for the first time demonstrated to the world that it was not India. The Pakistanis had sold the line throughout that it was India who was the aggressor. See, in Kashmir, they are doing this. The 99 war demonstrated to the world that no, India was a responsible country. The USA spoke up for you. Even China was muted. And if you look at that, I think tremendous. Present decade also has tremendous, but it's too close to it, whether it's the bankruptcy or for the first time we are looking at the poor as agents of change.
So the way I would define a decade is to look at what the country was at the beginning of a decade and what it was at the end of a decade. And on that basis, see which is a defining decade. First, let me eliminate the decades. So I would eliminate 60s, 70s, 80s. And as Shakti correctly said, the last decade is too close to us. So we are left with three decades, 50s, 90s, and 2000 to 2010. The 90s, which was the defining decade for two important reasons, which Dr. Swami already mentioned. One is that the world as we knew after independence ended in 91, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, end of the Cold War. The economy was in the worst condition ever after independence in 1991. Major economic crisis, major foreign policy challenges, and political crisis. You had Congress in disarray after two assassinations, opposition nowhere in a position to replace the Congress, series of coalition governments. So you had a political crisis, a foreign exchange crisis, and an economic crisis. What happens by the end of the decade? The economy recovers remarkably. In fact, the recovery from the crisis of 91 over the next decade is absolutely stunning. Secondly, foreign policy. We come out of the shadow of the Soviet Union, and by the end of the 90s, as Shakti mentioned, in Kargil, the United States changes its position, accepts line of control with the international border, a fundamental change in its South Asia policy. And we begin a dialogue with the United States for a new relationship. And on the political front, you have the emergence of two major parties, the Congress on the one side and the BJP. And you can see that the race that happened after the turn of the century, in which finally the BJP won that race, but Congress survived for 10 years.
So what then, which has been the most disastrous decade?
Disastrous decade is the first decade.
First decade?
Yes. He's a Nehruite, so maybe. because all the problems we have today were willfully created in the 50s.
I think it's become fashionable to demonize Jawaharlal Nehru. And even more fashionable to suddenly privilege Sardar Patel over Jawaharlal Nehru when both of them were colleagues in the same party.
Well, this week we are discussing a topic that we've been discussing for quite a few weeks now. But the only reason we are bringing it up yet again and again is there seems to be no resolution in sight. Of course, I'm talking about the Congress. And along with the Congress, the state of the opposition. Is the opposition getting its act together, or is it still reeling from the shock of the 2019 election defeat, I would say? Or is there some kind of bonding, some kind of a strategy in play that we are seeing? And should the Congress be taking the lead? If it should, then where's the leader? Is Priyanka Gandhi that leader in waiting?
I would say today exactly what I said in 2012 when Uttar Pradesh was going in for elections. I had said at that time that if the Congress wants a fighting chance in 2014, I'd written a column on this, then Rahul Gandhi should lead the campaign in UP and project himself as the chief ministerial candidate of Uttar Pradesh. Because if you remember, in 2009, Congress had done well in Uttar Pradesh. So in 2012, my view was that if Rahul Gandhi had established himself as the chief minister of Uttar Pradesh, for which I think there were very good reasons to believe that a campaign led by him could have revived the party at the grassroots, then he would be ready to see himself as a prime ministerial candidate. But of course, Rahul Gandhi wanted to become prime minister directly, not even a minister of cabinet or the government of India, so forget being chief minister. I would say the same thing today.
No matter what, whether officially or unofficially, the Congress requires the power of the Gandhis to power it forward, the charisma of the Gandhis. Now, let me take this a step forward. What I also said on your show was that the kind of fighting spirit that the Congress needs to revive itself with is the fighting spirit of Tilak and Mahatma Gandhi. I am not saying that she is in the league of Tilak and Mahatma Gandhi right now. I am also not saying that this is the Congress's moment. All I'm saying is this is the kind of spirit, not just the Congress, the entire opposition today desperately needs. And in my opinion, I think that Priyanka, what she's done is sort of lit a fire. Now, I'm not saying that this is going to turn into a wildfire, the forest is going to get burnt, but a chingari kafi hoti hai aag lagane ke liye. Agar ye chingari aag mein tabdeel hoti hai, to ye desh ke vipaksh ke liye and for the country, I think it's excellent.
He drew a good analogy about lighting a prairie fire, but I think it's early days. So, you know, it's not good enough for Priyanka to just land when there is a confrontation, and there are going to be several such confrontations in the Yogi Adityanath regime. There were and there are going to be, because Yogi Adityanath is consistently weighing in on the side of the powerful, the landed and the upper castes. He's kind of left the Dalits and the small number of tribals to their mercy. So Priyanka will have to make sure that the organization gets going before she can even hope to take electoral or political advantage of such situations.
And here I disagree with all of you, and
okay,
I feel
good.
That
which is why we called you here.
I feel that, you know, we really have to get over the siblings. I think Rahul Gandhi and Priyanka Gandhi, the myth about them has been busted a long time ago. We need 24/7 politicians. We've had socialites who've turned into politicians and they've done it very successfully. We have Naveen Patnaik, but he demonstrated a commitment that was far above and beyond the Gandhis. They have to get out of this tentpole event-based politics. You know, Rahul Gandhi goes to Bhatta Persol, we all follow him. Rahul Gandhi went to Niyamgari, we all followed him. Priyanka Gandhi goes to Sonbhadra, we all follow her. We have to stop this. We have to realize that the Congress actually is, you know, an amalgamation of splits. If Mamata Banerjee could split, if Sharad Pawar could split, tell me what is stopping such very, very bright politicians like Sachin Pilot, Jyotiraditya Sindhya, Milind Deora, Sushmita Dev, they're all very powerful and very popular politicians. What is stopping them from splitting and forming a Congress of their own and leaving the Gandhis to run their own little private domain? Why not?
Well, this week we are going to be discussing the situation in JNK, the fallout after removal of Article 370 and 35A, and also the impact on the ground and what it means for the security situation, for the cultural social situation, and the impact on India in general.
Priya, I landed in Srinagar on the very day itself when the article was abrogated, and I was in the air when Amit Shah implemented it in the Rajya Sabha. I stayed there for 10 days. Obviously, there's a lot of anger on the streets. But from the point of view of New Delhi, I think it's very well managed this time. I think the government learned a lot of lessons from 2016, when in the aftermath of the death of Hizbul terrorist commander Burhan Wani, the situation went out of control, really. So I think this time on, the government learned a lot of lessons. All over Kashmir Valley, I saw partial restrictions in place. There's, of course, a total communications blackout, which means that there's no landline, mobile or internet. Landlines have partially been restored now. But vehicular traffic was on, contrary to what you read in the New York Times or BBC. I mean, I was moving about in a normal civilian car with a local JNK number. I had no curfew pass, but I was not prevented from going anywhere. I traveled all over Kashmir Valley. I went to the southern parts. I went to Pulwama, which was almost like a liberated zone after Burhan Wani's death for a few weeks. But I faced no problem.
I partly agree with Rahul, because if you look at 2016 unrest, I think most of the casualties happened in first 10 days in the aftermath. And after that, it was the steam or the kind of anger generated with those casualties or the law and order situation, which kept on going for a few months. My sense is that the biggest problem at hand for the government is that there is no political system. And if at all there is a kind of an outpour or some degree of street violence in Srinagar, it's going to be very difficult to contain. Because the problem at the end of the day is that you need to have some sort of a lever or some sort of a management system where you can channelize the anger of the people. Because if you look at 2010, the unrest came in a very unexpected way. Nobody would have thought that there's going to be unrest, or for that matter, 2008 as well. Nobody would have imagined that the protests will be on such a large scale. In the short run, yes, managing the situation, controlling the law and order problem is good. It will remain this way, but we don't know what's going to happen next spring.
Most of the population doesn't even understand what is Article 370 all about. It is just a thing which is created, that something very special about it. And Article 370 is one place, 35 alpha another thing. Now that it's been revoked, the policy has been revoked out there, I see in the near to midterm, I see a lot of good things happening out there. If the peace stability comes in, there will be economic development, there will be employment generation, there will be aspirations of the youth will be met, a lot of good things happening. But the immediate term is very sensitive. It has to be handled very properly. There's empathy for the people. And like Khalid rightly said, anything can go wrong. And it may not be 370 itself, the trigger may be something else totally. Mm-hmm. So we have to guard against that, guard against inimical elements doing something which is wrong. And actually the people of Kashmir are just a pawn, actually. The thing comes from Pakistan, the control lies out there.
Most of these protests and even the demonstrations, I mean, before or like after like 2016 or 2018, most of them were well politically managed and properly organized, just the way you organize a systematic event, you know. Okay, and since, you know, all the troublemakers are behind the bars, you know, you can see the result, you know. Jamaat has been banned, you know, so they were acting as the key, you know, people like who used to control, organize, manage, you know, provide help with the logistics and all. So they are behind the bar. Okay, obviously there is a larger subtext of you know, I would say revulsion, rebelliousness, anger, frustration that is there in every, like in almost all the states. Definitely degrees in Kashmir are much higher, you know. But since most of these protests were organized by a select group of people, okay, that's why they were happening.
Well, the Modi government is going full steam ahead. It's completed its first 100, within the first 100 days only, it's done a whole lot of headline achieving reforms, whether it's what happened in Kashmir and also internationally with the Howdy Modi event. It's electorally is also going full steam ahead. The coming state elections are more or less the BJP is expected to get a walkover because there is really no opposition to stop his flow, which is what brings me to the main question. What is the road ahead? What is the plan ahead for the Modi government? Is he going to trip on his own plans because the opposition doesn't seem to be having a game plan? And above all, can he carry on winning with the economy being in such a bad way? How long can he keep this mirage going?
Well, certainly the momentum is in his favor at the moment. And it almost seems that the BJP has an aura of invincibility around it. But I always believe that in politics, to make predictions about the future without factoring in things that can possibly go wrong is a mistake. And the BJP also will make mistakes. You know, the only place where you start at the top is when you are digging a hole. So there are mistakes that you do when you have a mandate of this size. Time will judge it, and certainly the economy is not doing well. But the real reason why, to some extent, this momentum will carry on much longer is the absence of an organized opposition.
Many people have said that India deserves a better opposition. But it's not fair to ask the BJP why there is no better opposition. Really, I mean, the BJP's job is to grow, to win elections, to run the country well, and the opposition has to get its act together. We can't be really held accountable for that. Now, it is true that the economy is not doing optimally, but to say that it is in the doldrums is also not correct. We must see the grays, not just black and white. Please remember, the first term of the Modi government was about setting the foundations in place. Remember, after that, the economy went back up to 8% plus growth. So there are still people who have a rigid mindset that somehow today's growth rate is linked to decisions of 3 years ago. That's not the case, because we went back up to 8%. The dip down today is because of many factors. A lot of them are global in nature. Now, we also have a lot of things, a lot of unfinished business of decades of lack of reform, which are happening. The steps that have been taken within the last couple of months, they will take a quarter or two to kick in. So I remain optimistic that if you look forward 2 quarters from now, you will see the bounce back effect happening.
I would say all is not well, and on the economic downturn that the people are feeling it now. You know, retrenchments, of course, the GDP going down and so on. We know banking sector, et cetera, et cetera. My point is that the BJP is best at management of political perception. You know, even if it's bad news, how do you manage it politically? And this time in Modi too, it's a very interesting thing to watch how Mr. Narendra Modi is playing a different role. The what you call the statesman-like role, the macro picture, the world stage, to make India the Vishwa Guru. Howdy Modi, you know, the scale and the flair of it all, which he's very good at. I mean, he's what I would call an ace pracharak in every way, of the government program, of the party's ideology, reaching out to aspirational India and so on. It's Mr. Amit Shah. There seems to be a division
of he was work, saying, the two people,
which is not just looking after the party and how it's going to do, but virtually looking after the government. He's running the government, barring maybe three ministries. So the nuts and bolts of administration. are being looked after by Mr. Amit Shah, and the plan seems to be to actually achieve the core agenda of the BJP and the RSS by 2024, even before that, maybe by 2022.
My own criticism of this government has been that all of this we knew in July. I was expecting that the first budget of Nirmala Sitharaman in July 2019 would have had everything that she's announced since then. And I've said this.
I saw your tweet, in fact, saying she could have saved herself a lot of trouble.
I've said this, I've tweeted it, I've written about it. In fact, before July budget, I wrote a column in the Economic Times telling her that you want to be the next Manmohan Singh, then make this budget the budget in which you will do all the things which have not been done. And yet, it was not a budget speech. It was a political manifesto speech. It was the most disappointing budget speech I've heard in years. And I've said it again after the budget speech that, you know, this was a waste of opportunity. Then what happened? Then the government woke up and in the last 3 months since July announced a series of steps which could all have been done before.
Sanjay said that some of the steps on the economy could have been taken in July rather than later. Look, the point is we had some very massive transitions with the passing of Sushma Swaraj and Arun Jaitley not being, let me complete. A new finance minister coming on the job right away, if she took 4 weeks to take some decisions rather than in 1 week, because these reform measures were announced in August and in September, and yes, ideally, perhaps it should have happened in the budget in July. So I think that's a little bit of, it's not asking for too much.
Was it an unsettled finance minister who made the budget speech?
No, that's not the point. The point is, any time you have transition...
That's a debating point, but...
Look, you can try to be cute about these things.
How can a finance minister take time to be settled before a budget speech?
You can try to be cute. About these things, but to say that transitions don't have an effect... You know, these decisions were announced in August and September.
I have covered every single budget of this central government from 1990. So I know what goes into the preparation of a budget. To have argued, and I said this to the finance minister herself, to have argued that the government was not prepared in July to look at issues seriously for the long term is factually incorrect. Finance ministry is an ongoing enterprise. Finance ministers read out budget speeches written by their entire staff. They don't have to start thinking about the economy the day they become finance ministers. Otherwise, in 1991, July, you wouldn't have had the budget that Manmohan Singh read out, which was in the making for a few months before that.
Well, after Nirbhaya, we as a country and as a nation thought we'd seen the worst there was to come. But how wrong were we? Just a week ago, we saw the repeat of the same story, another brutal gang rape and murder of a young 27-year-old girl in Hyderabad. Where is the country heading to? Where are the laws that we have made during after Nirbhaya? More important, why aren't these being implemented? Are lawmakers right when they talk about lynching? Is that the answer? Is that what the nation is going to be reduced to? What can be done to prevent this? What can be done in the aftermath? That is something we are going to be discussing on Roundtable today.
I believe, look at prevention. When you break down this particular crime, you see that she parked her scooter at a toll plaza, which was covered by CCTV. We all talk about smart policing, and I'm sure Mr. Kant will tell us more about it. But was there no real-time monitoring of that CCTV footage? Did no one raise an alarm that there's a girl, there's a young woman who's parking her scooter there? There are people around her who look suspicious. So when we talk about prevention of a crime like this, you know, so much has been talked about safe spaces for women, why women should be allowed to loiter. This woman wasn't even loitering, she was just coming back from work. We talk about safe public transport, safe public spaces, well-lit public areas. This is not even a darkly lit area. This is a toll plaza. Then the body is dragged under a bridge, which is, of course, one of those shadow areas in a city. You know, urbanization will create problems like this. The other day, yesterday, there was an argument that, you know, these migrants are coming from various places and they're causing this. That's not the point. Urbanization will create problems like this. There will be a class divide. There will be a divide between the progressive, liberal-minded and those who still cannot understand, you know, a woman out there in, you know, independently mobile. So
the fact is that you have to account for this, and smart policing should account for this.
So far as the police reaction is concerned, in the Reddy's case in Hyderabad, I mean, what I know of it, probably that's true. I mean, the reaction, the initial reaction of police was extremely tardy.
Yeah.
It was terrible. It was terrible to say the least.
Yes.
And they deserve to be really flogged, I think. Absolutely. Those colleagues of ours, older colleagues, they don't deserve any kind of sympathy about it. They should be dismissed, in my opinion, because how can you, when the information is reaching police, for example, they have no business. And the girl is giving distress call to her sister and the father is calling up police. In that kind of situation, delay is absolutely fatal.
And the Home Minister is saying that why did the woman not call the police?
In Nirbhaya case, situation was very different. In Nirbhaya case, actually, you know, the police acted much better in that case. Yes. But here also, investigation was not bad. Investigation they carried out.
When they finally got down to
it. So you have to really think that, and what Kaveri said about preventive part of it, prevention is a long story. It's a tall order. This country has about 25 lakh policemen. And as of
they're clearly not enough.
I'll just tell you, 25, which is a very poor ratio. Population police ratio in India is abnormally low. And there these 25 lakh policemen means that maximum 5 lakh policemen can be on the roads or can be visible, can be on the places, which is totally disproportionate to the actual requirement of policing. The point I am trying to say that the numbers are increasing, the crimes are increasing, but then the treatment, but investigation, conviction, you might talk about it better, is hardly about 20%.
Nirbhaya happened in 2012. 7 years goes by, and then we only need an incident like this for us to
wake up again and say, oh my God,
yes. What happened to the fun? These guys are still not being punished. So the point is, it needs to be pushed. You know, we take off our foot off the accelerator. So the momentum is lost. And I hold myself accountable for it, including all of you. Because we wake up after how many years? 7 years. And now here we are there again talking, because it takes one more heinous death, murder, rape of a person to wake us up. Why? 7 years is a long, long time.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.